Lecture 7, CPU Hardware and Branch Prediction. We talked a little bit earlier in the previous topic about how multi-core processors became the norm, partly because clock speeds aren't going up anymore, and partly because this allows us to get more done in parallel. So we're going to discuss a little more detail on this today. But the kind of system that we are talking about when we talk about multi-core systems are processor cores execute instructions. A processor with more than one core can, in theory, be executing multiple unrelated instructions all at the same time, and that will work. Now, obviously, how much performance you get out of it will depend on the task that you're doing. If you are doing only one thing at a time, then, of course, having 8 cores available or something doesn't really get you very much benefit. However, if we have the right kind of workload and the problem that we're solving is amenable to it, we can actually benefit from having all of the different cores available. And the kind of system that we're talking about is, generally speaking, a symmetric multiprocessing system, SMP. And that means that there are identical processors or cores which are interconnected, usually using some sort of bus or other similar construct, and they share main memory. And SMP is the most common type of multiprocessing system. There have been lots of them over the years. Desktop PCs started to be SMP maybe 20 years ago, rarely, and much more commonly 15 years ago. So it's been moving along, and SMP is, of course, the norm now. Your phone, your laptop, your tablet, they're all symmetric multiprocessing type systems. An SMP system looks something like this. We have a couple of cores. Here we have a very simple one where we only have 2 cores. Now, of course, 4 is very common. 8, 16 more is nothing noteworthy. But they are separate, but they're included on the same CPU chip. And that same CPU chip itself, that's the physical thing that you buy. It comes in the box. If you're looking for a Ryzen one at the time of recording, they're hard to come by. And that's one CPU chip, and it contains multiple cores, one to many. And in some cases, 32 cores on a single physical chip, which does make it a little bit hard to count. But honestly, from the view of executing software, it doesn't matter all that much. Cores are places that we could schedule work. And that's what the operating system sees. So one chip, 8 cores, you will open it up in Task Manager and you will say, okay, there are 8 little graphs for the performance telling you about how busy each of those cores is, and there are places where you can schedule work. Now, shared memory will quickly become a bottleneck as a result of this, because ultimately there will be a lot of contention over the bus amongst all of the cores. Now, we can, in some hardware configurations, have hyperthreading supported. And what happens with hyperthreading is that our CPU core has the ability to have 2 threads in progress at the same time. And so we have a single core, but it's got 2 tasks in its hands right now. Now, there has to be some sort of context switching between those threads, and it will be either periodically, so that no thread is starved, or when there's a cache miss or other long event. And that means that some resources might be unused, and we can take advantage of that by having a second thread at the ready. Why not take advantage of it? Now, hyperthreading is not as good as doubling the number of cores. If you have an 8-core CPU with hyperthreading, it appears to the operating system as if it has 16 cores, because you are scheduling work on those 16 units of execution, but it's not as good as if you had a processor that supported 16 cores. When the hyperthreading threads are assigned to the same core, they have to share some resources. There will be some things where they have to wait for one another, and it is not quite the same as having two separate cores. Nevertheless, it's still a benefit. We're making use of time that otherwise we might not be able to, and it seems to be the case that having hyperthreading adds about 30% to your performance versus if you did not have hyperthreading. So not doubled, but nothing to sneeze at. And of course, your modern chip combines both such things, and you end up with something that looks like this. We have here a dual core with hyper-threading kind of CPU, and that's what a lot of them look like right now. You know, if you buy a modern CPU, a Ryzen 5800X, you'll see it's 8 core, 16 threads. That's their term for what Intel would call hyper-threading, and we end up with a lot of units of execution for your execution. When you look at it in Task Manager, you'll see those 16 little bar graphs, and very good. Older processors did this too. The Sun ones, UltraSpark T2, had 8 cores, each of which supporting 8 threads, all sharing a common level 2 cache. Okay, so that's an SMP type system. There exist non-SMP type systems. Cell, which is used in the PlayStation 3, has a non-SMP architecture because not all processors are the same. We will revisit that a little bit later. And of course, SMT, simultaneous multi-threading, is the non-Intel branded name for what we commonly call hyper-threading. And it is using these idle CPU resources. Like I said, it only gives about 30% performance improvement. The non-SMP PlayStation 3 has a PowerPC main core, but 7 synergistic processing elements, SPEs. So basically the ones that are very good at drawing things for graphics. They are special purpose processors, and therefore they're not good for everything, but they are very good at the one thing that they do. But that makes it not a symmetric multiprocessing system because, well, the different processors, because specialized, can't all do the same thing, so not everything is equally substitutable. And in SMP systems, all CPUs have uniform, as in the same access to resources, but there can be a non-uniform memory access, and that means that CPUs access different resources at different speeds, and resources here could be anything. It doesn't have to be memory, although we frequently imagine that it is, and that would be a consideration for scheduling, where you schedule tasks on CPUs where they can access resources faster. There exists some server boards where you put 2 chips on the CPU, and there's also 2 banks of RAM. And if that's the case, there is a possibility of non-uniform memory access, where memory that's in the bank of the other CPU is slower to access than memory that's in the bank of the current CPU, in which case, this is a problem, only in the sense that it would be slower if we access things that are far away. So we want the operating system, where possible, to schedule things on whatever is the closest to the data, whatever CPU is closest to it, makes the most sense to choose. For that reason, operating systems have the idea of processor affinity, in which you have, designation about which CPUs are basically your favorite. And each task, in this case a processor thread, can be associated with an individual processor or a set of processors, and it's useful to take advantage of existing caches, either from the last time the task ran or multiple tasks that are using the same data. This affinity is good in some scenarios. You can use it as one way to reserve a certain CPU for a certain process if it's extremely important. As the saying goes, if it's detecting incoming missiles or something, then yeah, obviously it's important that you don't let that fall by the wayside. But oftentimes, in terms of absolute performance, yes, there is a miss penalty in cache misses if a task is assigned to a CPU that isn't necessarily the one it ran on before. However, if another CPU would be sitting idle, it's faster to just go there, use its resources, and not just wait for your favorite CPU to become available. That doesn't really make sense. Okay, so with our understanding of how symmetric multiprocessing and all that works, we're actually going to take a little bit of time to dig into branch prediction and misprediction and see what actually goes on. Now, a lot of what we are seeing here takes place in compiler level and in CPU level analysis. So when the compiler is compiling your program, it can look at things and make decisions and rearrange instructions to optimize your performance. You can also expect that when a stream of instructions has been fed to the CPU, the CPU could also look at that and say, well, I know a shortcut, I can think of a way to address something more efficiently, and that can actually happen. So we should expect that it will. In any case, whatever we are facing, if there is a loop, if there is a conditional, in this case an if block or a switch or when block or match block, depending on what language you're using, or even the dreaded go to, which I maintain is a swear word in C, so I'll put a loony in the swear jar, I guess, you end up with an assessment of what's going to happen. By default, you might have learned some sort of rule that says we'll assume that forward branches are not taken and backward branches are taken. That's a strategy. Is it a good one? We'll see. So in the beginning, this didn't happen at all. No attempt was made at predicting whether branches were going to get taken, and you know, the CPU would come across one instruction, it would do one instruction, and that was that. And if an instruction required a branch, there was no real issue, because we waited for that instruction to be finished before we made any decision about what to do. But we don't do that anymore, because we have pipelining. And so it's more efficient to guess, in the hopes that we are correct, what is the next step, than it would be to just wait for the result of this to be resolved before we go on. So, yeah, I mean, you know, the CPU in the pipelining scenario fetches the next instruction while decoding the previous one and so on, and if the evaluation results in a branch, we might have to flush the pipeline. That does mean there is some wasted effort in the simple DLX model that we've previously discussed, where there's five stages of execution. You know, there's not a huge penalty. We've wasted some time and effort, but you know, we lost 3 CPU cycles or something like that, or you know, we lost 10 CPU cycles in total. It's like, well, okay, if our CPU is running at 3 gigahertz, we have 3 billion cycles every second. Is it a big deal that we lost 10 of them? Probably not. But pipelines keep getting longer and longer and longer, and it varies, of course, by what CPU you're looking at. As I recall, the Pentium 4, and again, this would be about 15 years prior to recording, had a instruction pipeline length something on the order of 32 stages, so it gets a lot more expensive because there are a lot more things in progress. So that leads us naturally to the idea of branch prediction, and there has to be a decision made about whether we think the branch is taken or not. And as we'll see going through our examples, you could base your decision on several things. The recent execution history, perhaps. That's a way of making a prediction. If you think that the best indicator of future behavior is past behavior, this is a good way to guess. Anyway, if we guess correctly, it minimizes the cost of the branch, really cuts it down to zero effectively. And if we guess wrong, we flush the pipeline, there is a performance penalty, and the thing is that guessing is better than nothing. If we, you know, if we never guessed, we always just waited, then obviously guessing is better than nothing. But how much better than nothing is determined by how successful we are at guessing. So the compiler and CPU's branch prediction routines are pretty smart. Trying to outsmart them isn't necessarily a good idea, but there do exist ways that you can give the compiler hints about what you think is going to happen, whether it's likely or unlikely. And I've got an example that I've written in Rust that is going to investigate, can we give a good hint, and does it help? So the instructions that we are going to provide are saying whether it's likely or unlikely, and it's an experimental feature in Rust and only available in nightly builds. That is to say, it's unstable, and it's not the kind of feature that you get by default when you just install Rust the regular way. You can sort of use it. You risk that it breaks in the future because, as an experimental feature, you don't have a strong guarantee that it will be supported. So to actually use one of these nightly builds, you have to install the nightly stuff from Rust and specify the feature at the top of your source file with a little macro that says this is the feature that I want to use. What we are going to look at here is the effect of a hint on what is ultimately a very simple program. So we have a function f. It takes a parameter a of integer 32 bits, and it returns an integer of 32 bits, and it actually just returns whatever input is provided to it. So it doesn't do anything exciting. So we'll let size be 100,000, and we will create a vector using the vector creation macro. And this takes two arguments. The first thing is what we're filling it with, so we're initializing all values to be zero. After the semicolon, we're saying what is the size, what is the capacity of that vector. So the statement creates a vector with capacity of 100,000, and all elements in it are zero. So we're going to then declare M1 and M2. These will be 32-bit integers as well. That'll be inferred by the compiler. And they both start out as zero, and they are mutable. So what we'll do is in a for loop here, j from 0 to 1,000, and then inside that another for loop from k from 0 to size 100,000. What we'll do is go into the vector and get the value at index k and compare it to zero. If that's true, then m1 is going to be f of m plus m1 plus 1. So provide m1 plus 1 as the argument to function f and then assign that value back to m1. Otherwise, it's 2. Okay, sounds good. So here's what we'll do. We'll test it first with no hint, and then using the enabled core intrinsics feature, we will put likely around the if condition and then unlikely and see if that's correct. So here's what running it yielded. So no hint at all. Here's what we got. So by default, with no hint, it takes 6.657 seconds, plus minus a little bit, over 10 runs. With likely, providing the likely hint, well, it helped. Not at all. It actually made it worse. Our misprediction here was was worse. So if we said it was likely that it was going to evaluate to zero, then what actually happened? We got worse performance. I mean, by about 1/10 of a second, but that's still measurable in this case. It's not so small it's lost in the noise. Keep in mind, I've run these tests with Hyperfine, so we ran it over 10 runs, so the data that we're looking at isn't affected too badly by outliers. And if we had the unlikely hint, then that made it even worse. Again, with 10 runs, it's not any better. This scenario is maybe not a super great one for the use of hints. But hints don't help the compiler in this program. And we can show by using this that they're not always a benefit. Even if we're pretty sure that we're right, it's not necessarily beneficial. It's very hard to outsmart the compiler. Maybe it is better if we don't try. So there do exist the hints. You can use them if you're sure that it helps, but test that assumption. Don't assume that it will always be of benefit to apply a hint when you know that you're correct, because maybe it's not. You should test that and see for sure. All right, so now it's time for a deeper dive into branch prediction. And we can write software. Hardware will make it fast, at least as much as possible. And if we understand that, then we understand why that can break down, why it might have some trouble. So there are two main points that I want you to pick up from this discussion about branch prediction. And it's number one, how does branch prediction work? That is, we are trying to dig into the details about what actually happens to predict a branch and whether it is likely to be successful or not at predicting it, but also applying an expected value computation to predict performance. That is, given some numbers, can we put together a little calculation, back of the envelope kind of math that says, well, if these numbers are correct, then we expect it will take this long. That kind of thing is very useful in terms of making a decision. If you are being asked to evaluate some option, should we do X, should we do Y, you can take a look at your data, put a little calculation together and say, all right, well, if this happens X percent of the time and this happens Y percent of the time and the costs are this and that, then you could produce an overall measure that gives you some information about what you think is the average behavior. All right, so here we go. Using some pseudocode, branch if not equal x 0, then we go to the else label, otherwise do stuff, and then we go to the end label. And if we went to the else label, we do things instead. And the question is, what happens in this execution? Which one is correct? The branch instruction will be followed by either stuff or things, and pipelining doesn't know in advance which one it's going to be, so there will be some guessing. With no prediction, we serialize, as we've discussed. We have to wait for the branch to be evaluated before we do anything. And if our prediction is correct, we save time. So it takes three cycles instead of four. But if we're wrong, then something is off and we have to throw out our bad prediction. Okay, good so far. So we're going to put together a cartoon model of how our computer works. Oversimplify everything a little bit, but sufficient to actually, put some numbers to things and do the math. So let's pretend our pipeline CPU executes on average one instruction per cycle, and we'll just leave it at that. It's one instruction per cycle. No need to worry about outlying cases or anything. That's just the number that we're going to go with. Okay. If we are correct in predicting a branch, then it doesn't have any extra cost. It's just one cycle. If we mispredict a branch, the penalty for that is 20 cycles. Okay, so that's reasonable. We also need to know how often branches occur, and we'll assume that the instruction is 80% non-branches and 20% branches. That might actually be very high as a percentage of branches, but let's just imagine that that's what we're going to go with for the sake of putting together a calculation. Okay, so we'll do a little math. No trigonometry needed. This meme is amusing to me because I'm given to understand it comes from a telenovela where this character has learned that some other character is pregnant and she's trying to do the math on how long this character has been pregnant. I don't really know because I haven't watched the telenovela, but I don't understand what geometry has to do with any of it, but that's okay. Anyway, so if there's no prediction, so our non-branch percentage, so that's 80% of our instructions take one cycle, so 0.8 times one, and our branch instruction, so that's 20%, 0.2 times 20 gives us an average of 4.8 cycles. So the average instruction here retires, as they say, is completed after 4.8 cycles. That's pretty slow. With perfect branch prediction, then our non-branch percentage, so again, 80% complete in one cycle and 20% also complete in one cycle because we magically got it right every time. And in this simplistic model, we make our code run 4.8 times faster with branch prediction. Not bad. So, all right, let's get started with a simple strategy. We will consider more advanced strategies as we go along. So, if our strategy is dumb as rocks, it's just predict that the branch is always taken. You could also say predict the branch is never taken would have the same outcome. But if we got 70% accuracy, then our cycles per instruction looks like this. So for the cases that we get right, which is the non-branch instructions, that's 80% of them. And for 70% of the ones that we were having a branch instruction, so that's why 0.7 times 0.2 is in the bracket on the left, times one cycle, plus the 30% of the time we get it wrong, times the 20% of instructions that are branches, times 20 cycles, gives us an average of 2.14 cycles to complete an instruction. So that's already a huge improvement. We don't even have to be good at predicting. The simplest possible thing of just saying, yep, this always happens, you know, assume it is always sunny, is actually much better than no guessing at all. All right, so we can build on that. So I mentioned earlier the idea of do you assume forward branches are different branches? Do you assume forward branches are different from backward branches? And that kind of thinking is based on the idea of loops, that loops happen a lot in your program, and loop branches are, by definition, usually backwards. They are go back to the start of the loop, you know, do these instructions again. Okay, so you could design a branch predictor which says, you know, predict taken for backwards and not taken for forwards. You just compare the destination address with the current address, and based on whether it's bigger or smaller, you know which way you're going. So let's say that that increases our accuracy to 80%. Okay, so if we get it 80% right when it comes to predicting, our average cycles is now 1.76. And this is a real strategy. It was used by the PowerPC 601, which admittedly is a 1993 processor, so it's not exactly very modern. However, it was implemented in a real system, and it, you know, again, using our cartoon model, provides significant improvement. That idea that, you know, forward versus backwards, or always choosing the same direction, those are a static scheme for prediction. That is, we always make the same prediction at each branch. But actually, we also talked about the idea of remembering what happened last time, because that might be instructive. So let's try that. This is kind of important when program execution has phases with distinct behaviors. A compiler is kind of a good example of a program that has distinct phases, because there's parts about reading in your code, and there's analyzing it, and there's producing the binary and all those things. So that they're all distinct phases of the program. And so we'll talk about dynamic schemes. So the first approach that we'll talk about as a dynamic scheme is a very simple one, and it is just remember what happened last time. So when we were at this memory address, can we remember what happened? So yeah, all right, you know, last time I saw this branch, it was taken. So okay, let's do that. And it's a one-bit scheme, because we only have to store one bit of data to tell us whether or not our prediction is taken or not taken. And obviously we can't possibly store all branches in the program, so we'll use, say, the lowest 6 bits of the address to identify branches. Doing so raises the prospect of aliasing, that is, different branches with different behavior mapped to the same spot in the table. So there is a possibility that just by coincidence, if two things are, you know, offset by some multiple of the 6 lowest bits, we end up with, if they're offset to have the same 6 lowest bits, we end up with two things that are quite different, ending up with the same prediction. So we get, in this case, 85% accuracy, for example, and we can see that that drops our cost down from 1.76 cycles per instruction to 1.57. So we did have to have more hardware. That is, there's more actual physical stuff in the CPU to remember this and get it done. But we do get noticeable performance improvements, because remember that every instruction, although most of them complete in one cycle, on average they are now completing in 1.57 cycles instead of 1.76. And multiply that by the number of instructions in your program, and you can see how it makes a big difference. You know, there are billions and billions and billions of cycles executing in your program, assuming it's running for some wall clock measurable amount of time. And if your program is running over the course of an hour, that's a lot of CPU cycles that are going into it, so even a small improvement here makes a big difference in the total completion time from the perspective of the user. Okay, let's improve a little bit, and let's say, well, what if a branch is almost always taken, but is occasionally not? So it's something like we have a streak of true where the branch is taken, and then occasionally there's an N where the branch is not taken, and then a whole bunch of times it will be taken again. So we have a loop that's in a function, you know, we iterate over the loop lots of times, and then we exit from the loop, something happens, and then this function runs again, so we're going to be executing it again, and our expectation would be actually that we're going to execute the loop many times. However, because in a one-bit scheme, just whatever happened last time is the decision, when we break out of the loop, that means last time we decided, oh, actually, it's not taken, and that's our future prediction, which is wrong. So we end up getting penalized twice, so to speak, for the misprediction. The first time when we predict not taken, which is kind of unavoidable, and then once when we mispredict the next taken, which we could in theory avoid. And so when we want to use a 2-bit scheme, we use a 2-bit saturating counter. And what makes it a saturating counter is if it's already 1-1, if it's 2 bits, so they're both 1, and you know, we're going to add 1 to it, because it's saturating, nothing happens, it remains 1-1. So every time we see a taken branch, we increment the counter, so it goes 0 to 1 to 2 to 3, and if it's already 3, 1-1 in binary, we're not adding any more to it. And the same is true for decrementing. If it's at 0, then we try to decrement. We don't decrement it at all, it remains at 0, so it is saturating. And if the counter is 00 or 01, we predict not taken. If it's 10 or 11, we predict that it is taken. So this covers a common sort of use case where, like, oh, you know, on occasion we don't do this, but don't let it become the assumed norm. Now, with the 2-bit counter, we can have fewer entries at the same size, so it would take more hardware and more storage if we wanted to have the same amount of branches predicted, or we could have a smaller table for remembering them with the same amount of hardware, but we'll do better when we encounter branches. So let's say that that gives us 90% accuracy. And sure enough, that gets us about 1.38 cycles per instruction, which again is quite a nice drop down from 1.57 that we saw before. And this was used in a number of chips from 1977, the NLS1, through the first Pentium processors in 1993. Now, that's still sort of not taking patterns into account as much as it could be, because given the following for loop, which, yes, is written in C, but there's really no reason that it matters what it's written in, because it's the assembly that matters. In this case, the last three executions of the branch determine the next direction. So if we know that this is what the loop does, and we know it has a fixed number of iterations, we actually know that if we've seen taken three times in a row, the next one is not taken. And if we just based it on what has happened recently, we wouldn't get the best possible prediction, because it's known to us by observing the behavior of this loop that, in fact, if it's been taken three times, that's it, we're breaking out of the loop. So what we can do is store this branch history. And from a branch address and history, we derive an index, and we just put those things together, and they point us into a table somewhere, and our tables contain 2-bit saturating counters. And the history helps determine our prediction, as well as where we are. So we've seen, okay, when we were in this scenario and previous predictions were X, our new prediction is Y. That might give us something like 93% accuracy, and the Pentium MMX is multimedia extensions, used a 4-bit global branch history. The important change here is that the CPU is keeping a separate history for each branch, and therefore the branch address determines what history is getting used. And this 2-bit level adaptive local is going to concatenate the address and the history to get the index, pointing us to a 2-bit counter. And it's clear at this point we are encountering diminishing returns because now we might get 94% accuracy. But nevertheless, it's still working for us. We might get down to 1.23 cycles. In terms of our average execution time. And the Pentium Pro, Pentium 2, and Pentium 3 CPUs all use this. Again, those are all late 90s CPUs. We've not yet broken into this millennium, but we are getting close. Now, instead of doing something like this, instead of concatenating the address and the history, we could use XOR on them. It allows using more bits for both the history and the address, which simplifies the design. This is one of those, it would be neat kind of extensions to go into, but we're already pretty far into the details of how branch prediction works, and we'll just kind of cut it off here. There exist, of course, other predictors, and people have built them, and the kind that you see in your CPU today is obviously going to be much more advanced than the one from a CPU of 1999. The predictors might better handle aliasing, where different branches or histories map to the same index in the table. As you get sort of more area to work with on your chips and you have more available hardware and hardware is cheaper to make, you can keep a longer address, which makes it easier to differentiate between which address you're looking at. So there's less chance of aliasing giving you a wrong prediction. That sort of thing. All things become possible when we are dealing with more advanced hardware. In any case, to summarize the topic, branch prediction enables pipelining without a huge penalty in our execution, and much increased performance. We looked at creating a model which gives you a way of estimating what is the benefit. So we could say, like, if we improved our branch prediction rate by 1%, how does that affect the outcome? How does that affect the execution of our program? And the good news is that our accuracy is pretty high. It's possible to predict most branches. In fact, the overwhelming majority of them, you know, really, you know, if you got it 90% right, we would consider that right now in branch prediction to be not as good as it could be. But in the grand scheme of things, it's actually very helpful. And processors are pretty good at dealing with it. And we can use these hardware features to actually identify and improve the performance of the program. If we know that something is going wrong with branch prediction, we could give it a hint. Again, hints are not always good, but if you determine for your use case that it helps, by all means, give it the hint.